Okay, so as said in previous presentations, the species of Pickersgill reed frog is endemic to the coast of KwaZulu-Natal, ranging all the way from Warner Beach in the south all the way to St. Lucia Village in the north. And due to its decreasing range of occupancy, it's been uplisted on the IUCN from rare in 1994 to vulnerable in 96. It was further uplisted to endangered in 2004 and it is now currently listed as critically endangered since 2010. So there has been a threatened amphibian program that is part of the EWT, which had listed a number of objectives in order to conserve Hyperolus pickersgill species. So these are the various project objectives. One of them is the development of a biodiversity management plan, which as was spoken about in the previous presentation has been done, as well as continuing surveying for new subpopulations, securing at least 30% of the population in the next 3 years through habitat management, development and implementing standardized long-term monitoring protocols at priority sites, as well as identifying restoration needs and possibilities at existing and historical sites. And then lastly, one of their project objectives was to determine the impact of habitat fragmentation on populations using genetic analysis. And this is where the NZG played a role. So we have a genetic toolbox. So we like to not just look at a single marker. We'll look at mitochondrial genes, we'll look at nuclear genes, and try to come up with answers in terms of genetic diversity as well as population structure. So the samples that were included in the study, there were 48 samples that were collected from 12 localities along the KZN province. So we did not sample all the localities, but sampling is ongoing. But as you can see, samples were collected from St. Lucia all the way to Sizela. Samples are stored at the NZG National Biobank, which follows international standards for repository operations such as ISPR, ESBB, and GGBN. So the first result that we found was that the genetic distance between individuals was very, very low. It varied from 0 to 2.3%, whereas the genetic distance between pickersgill reed frog and our outgroups was very high. So that was about 13.6 to about 23.3%. So we did a phylogenetic analysis using both 16S as well as CO1 regions of the mitochondrial genome. And we found that the two trees that we were obtained from these two regions were exactly the same. And what we found was that there was a single main clade with very, very high support. So it had a 99% bootstrap support. There was some subclades within this tree, but they were very poorly supported with bootstrap values below 70%. We then looked at diversity estimates of the mitochondrial genes, and we found that the nucleotide diversity was very low, whereas the haplotype diversity was moderate to high. So this may indicate that the pickersgill reed frog is an expanding population because it's following expected trends of high haplotype diversity as well as low nucleotide diversity. So we also did median joining networks, and what we found is that the majority of the samples had the same haplotypes, indicated in the first diagram by haplotype 2 and 4, and indicated in the second diagram by haplotype 3. So most of the individuals had these common haplotypes. We then developed microsatellite markers for our next generation sequencing. So we always like to develop species-specific markers. So we conducted next-generation sequencing. We identified 26 microsatellite markers that we then tested. and we were able to optimize 15 of those markers. We then analyzed the markers just to see if they were good, and we found an absence of null alleles. Linkage disequilibrium was not detected, which means that the markers were not close together, they were distributed across the genome, and all markers were in Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium. So we found that the genetic diversity estimates were very, very high. Even though the sample sizes in some of the populations was very low. So overall we had a mean expected heterozygosity of 0.629 and observed heterozygosity of 0.769, and the number of alleles was about 3.5. We also found a lack of inbreeding in all the populations. We then did structure. So using the microsatellite markers, we can then determine if there's different populations or if all the frogs are one population. So the problem with structure is it can't identify one population. The lowest it can go is two. So you kind of have to take the results that you get from structure and then see if it matches up with what you'd expect it to look like. So as you can see, even though it showed that structure was two, it's definitely not two populations, because or else you would have seen, say, green bars for population 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and then red bars for the rest. So it's not showing an even distribution, so that's why we rather say that in this case K is one, that there's one population. So our study sought to examine the genetic structure of Pickersgill reed frog using both mitochondrial and nuclear data. And we were able to confirm the status of Pickersgill reed frog as a genetically distinct species in the Hyperoleus genus. And we found that there was no specific phylogeographic structure among individuals that were sampled across those 12 populations. We also found that the diversity was very high, and it's equivalent to other amphibians which are demographically stable, which is very good. So although Pickersgill reed frogs has high diversity, it should be considered that this species is in a landscape that is continually changing, as well as habitat that's continually changing. And also the problem with the frog is that it's only found in two protected areas. And additional localities throughout its range is not known because of its cryptic nature. So there is a need to conserve these populations through preservation of natural habitats, and this should be a top priority so that we can keep this high level of genetic diversity. Thank you.